Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to another new edition of Africa Today, where we get you the latest news taking place on the African scene. And our main topic today will be the visit of the Mauritanian president, Wild Abdelaziz, Mohamed Wild Abdelaziz, to Egypt. But we'll first have a look at this report. Nigerian troops rescued 21 people abducted by Boko Haram militants and killed 9 rebels as it pressed on with its offensive against the insurgent group in the country's northeast. More details in the following report.
Boko Haram released a new video denying any suggestion it might surrender just over a week after shadowing leader Abdelkader Shekau appeared in a rare message looking dejected and frail. Shekau, unseen on camera for more than a year, released an unverified video late last month saying his time in charge of the Nigerian militant group may be coming to an end. If the video indeed depicts Shekau, he appears thin and listless, delivering his message without his trademark fiery rhetoric. It prompted speculation from the army that the group was on the verge of collapse in the face of a sustained military counterinsurgency. However, in Friday's message, Boko Haram maintained it was a potent fight and force, with men holding AK-47s, posing in front of Toyota Hilux pickup trucks and a lorry mounted with a military cannon. In March 2015, Boko Haram pledged allegiance to the Daesh group, another deadly terror organization. But there were few signs that Boko Haram, now styled as Daesh in West Africa province, has drawn benefits from the partnership. Since then, Nigeria's army has won back swath of territory from the militants, liberating thousands of people who have been living under Boko Haram control. More than 2.6 million people have fled their homes since, but some of the internally displaced have begun returning.
Welcome back, and moving on to Somalia, the Pentagon announced that a U.S. drone strike has targeted a senior Shabab leader in Somalia who was believed to have been plotting attacks against Americans in Mogadishu. Details follow.
Said a U.S. drone strike in Somalia has targeted a key leader of Al-Shabaab militant group who was involved in 2 attacks in Mogadishu more than a year ago that killed more than 30 people, at least 3 Americans among them. Several U.S. officials said he and 2 others were killed. Hassan al-Dahour was targeted in airstrikes, but the U.S. military was still assessing the results. Pentagon spokesman Peter Cook said that in a statement. Other U.S. officials speaking on condition of anonymity because they weren't authorized to discuss the operation said it occurred about 20 miles south to Jilib in southern Somalia, not far from the Kenyan border, killing Dahouri and 2 others. Cook said Dahouri helped facilitate a deadly Christmas Day 2014 attack at International Airport of Mogadishu and a March 2015 attack at the Mecca El Mukarrama Hotel. U.S. citizens were among those killed in 2 attacks. One senior official also said that Dahouri was believed to be involved in plotting more attacks that would have targeted U.S. citizens. Cook said Dahouri, who was also a member of Al-Qaeda, worked for Al-Shabaab Security and Intelligence Wing. Killing Dahouri would be a significant blow to Al-Shabaab's operational planning and ability to conduct attacks. In the Christmas 2014 assault, gunmen attacked the African Union's main base, leading to an exchange of gunfire between militants and soldiers that killed at least 9 people, including 3 soldiers.
Welcome back, and we're glad to be joined today by Ambassador Ali Al-Hifni, former Deputy Foreign Minister. Good afternoon, sir, and thank you for joining us.
Good afternoon, Yvi.
Sir, the visit of the Mauritanian president is the first official visit in 40 years by a Mauritanian president. How do you see the significance of this visit and the timing of the visit? And, of course, the agreements, several agreements were signed in several fields and also a memorandum of understandings. Would you please shed more light on the issue?
Well, we have established relations even earlier. And the 2 capitals, they have missions. Each other's missions are there in the 2 capitals. We have had a constant and regular wonderful relationship. It changes of different visits, different level visits. It's true that this is the first visit affected by the president, but it shouldn't hide the fact that first, the two countries, they cherish very much their relations with the other. Mauritania, as well as Egypt, they are members of the Arab League of States. They are members of the African Union. The two diplomacies, they always engage themselves in consultations, maybe through the group of the PRs, the permanent representatives of the group of ambassadors, whether Arab ambassadors or African ambassadors, at the United Nations in New York or in Geneva, or in Addis Ababa. In fact, we have a good relationship in spite of the fact that Egypt is to the extreme northeast of North Africa, or the African continent, and Mauritania is to the extreme west. We have a joint cultural heritage. We speak the same language. It's good to have Prince Mohammed for this visit that comes at a very appropriate time, for Egypt as well as for Mauritania. For Egypt, because Mauritania is going to host, instead of Morocco, on the 25th and 26th of July next, the Arab summit. The situation in the Arab world being what it is, so for the host country and the country where the Arab League of States headquarters are, and a country which is Egypt, that have always played and still plays an important role at the Arab level, it's important to hold consultations and to exchange views.
As preparations for the Arab League summit, the upcoming summit.
Mm-hmm. And also to interact with the people at the Arab League of States. The current Secretary General will not be there for the summit. He will be replaced by the newly appointed Secretary General. So it's always good for the Mauritanian officials to interact with the Arab League. So within the preparations process of that summit will be, which will be a very important summit, because it comes at a very crucial time for the whole Arab region. I mean, the development of the situation in Iraq, in Syria, in Yemen, in Libya, the situation in Lebanon, the talks being held, and we have the French envoy for the Middle East on Middle Eastern affairs in Cairo right now. So renewing the talk about reviving the peace process between Palestinians and Israelis. In fact, there is a lot to be discussed at that that summit. Especially from this angle, it's very important for the two leaders to consult, to interact, to discuss, to exchange views, to prepare for a successful Arab summit.
What's the main? What are the main topics on the agenda of the Arab League summit?
Well,
of course, in addition to the situation in Iraq, Libya, and Syria,
there is a pending issue, which is the reform within the Arab League of States, the secretariat. And I believe this will be one of the tasks of the new Secretary General, and how to push the joint action of the Arab countries forward, and especially if we are talking about the economic cooperation, technical cooperation, because this should be the foundation of any future development of the overall situation in the Arab world. I mean, it should be based on a sounder economic and technical cooperation in all fields, economic and technical fields.
Mm-hmm. Also, among the major issues discussed was the issue of terrorism and the cooperation in the field of fighting or combating terrorism in the Africa region. Would you please elaborate on this?
Now, you may recall that we had recently a conference of the ministers of defense of the SANSAD group,
right,
which is Sahel and Sahara,
right,
with the presence of about 27 countries, including Egypt. And that conference should have been held earlier. But anyway, we finished by holding it and here in Egypt, in Sharm el-Sheikh. And it was an important, in view of the important event or important conference, in view of the results that resulted out of that conference. There was an agreement between all the countries pertaining to the necessity to fight together on a regional basis terrorism, because it has spread all over the place in the SANSAD region,
right,
in the Sahel and Sahara,
mm-hmm,
and with the possibility of spreading even further to the central and southern part of Africa.
Right.
Now, the North Africa has been affected, the Western Africa has been affected, and even some parts of
South Africa.
Central Africa, and of course, Eastern Africa, we have problems in other countries also to the east.
What are the main factors behind the rise of terrorism in most of the African countries, in addition, of course, to what's taking place in the Middle East region?
The lack of concerted global effort, the double measures, the lack of the political will as far as some key players in the international community that are providing sanctity, financing, arming, training, covering for the terrorist groups. So as long as we are going to have such an environment that prevail in the regional, national, regional, and international efforts to combat terrorism, are not going to have a sound fighting against terrorism. And terrorism is going to spread over the whole place.
Right. How far do you think the joint African forces and the joint Arab forces, and of course also we have the joint Islamic forces, how far do you think they will succeed in combating terrorism in the region?
Well, you see, this is not just the responsibility of the countries, because it has exceeded the local level. Okay. Look at Daesh. I mean, it's moving freely
in Libya, in Syria, in Iraq, in Syria, in Libya, in Yemen.
Mm-hmm. You cannot count on only the local or the regional or the international effort. I mean, I'm talking about the United Nations, but you have to focus also on the regional level. And you have to focus on the role which is supposed to be played by the regional organizations. I'm talking about the African Union in Africa. I'm talking about the Arab League of States, as far as the Arab world is concerned. I'm talking about the Organization of Islamic Cooperation in the Islamic world. So this is why there have been calls from Cairo here, as far as the composition of a joint Arab force, and the successful convening upon invitation of
the
number of
the
Islamic countries that have taken part in military maneuvers in Saudi Arabia lately, and also that important conference of the ministers of defense of the SANSAD, as you said.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, the regional organizations, they have a responsibility.
Mm-hmm.
They have a responsibility to contain that disease and to fight together, to concert the to ensure the combination of the forces of the member countries, mm-hmm. that there would be a collective work, collective action. There could be a better exchange of information, especially between the security and the secret services. Mm-hmm. But also, as it has been agreed upon at Sharm el-Sheikh at the Ministers of Finance Conference, mm-hmm. Which is the cooperation as far as securing the borders. So it's not only the country that's going to have the unique task of securing the border, but also the cooperation of other members of the CENSAT to come to its help to ensure that its borders will not be violated and there would be there wouldn't be intrusion or more intrusions of those forces into this or that country, members of the CENSAT.
Right, and if you move back to the economy and the two presidents, President Abdel Fattah el-Sisi and the Mauritanian President Mohamed Ould Abdelaziz signed six memorandum of understandings, of understanding on health, culture, mining, population, livestock, and maritime transport. How do you see the significance of economic cooperation with Mauritania?
Listen, the African countries, all of them, they follow what's happening in Egypt now, in spite of the problems or the challenges that we face every now and then. But they are fully aware of the fact that we have a new setting in Egypt, mm-hmm. We have a new leadership, mm-hmm. We have a new parliament, we have a more active foreign policy. Mm-hmm. We have signed all along those last 1.5 years or 2 years many deals and many memos, many agreements, mm-hmm. with a large number of countries. They have followed, and some of them they've been present for the inauguration of the new Suez Canal.
Right.
They have attended the Sharm el-Sheikh, some of them, the Sharm el-Sheikh Economic Conference in March the last year, in 2015. Mm-hmm. They have been here for the Africa 2016 Forum lately in Sharm el-Sheikh. So they know that we have a new agenda, we have a new scheme, we have a new plan, long-term plan, 15-30. We have a very ambitious plan to transform our economy, to introduce a lot of reforms, mm-hmm. To turn Egypt into a more productive country, to solve, as the time goes, the problem of unemployment. Mm-hmm. So they follow on this and they appreciate what's being happening in Egypt. What are we aiming? What is the Egyptian dream? Or what shape does the Egyptian Renaissance takes for the time being or will take in the coming years? They follow with a great deal of attention what's happening in Egypt, you know, right. And aspire at working with Egypt, mm-hmm. cooperating with Egypt, mm-hmm. Trading with Egypt, and making the best use of whatever Egypt has accumulated as experiences and expertise. And they know that the good point, the strong point in Egypt is the intellectuals. I mean, the cadres, they have a great potential that if we could put it at the service of development in other African countries. So now, President Mohamed, President of Mauritania, is willing to make the best use of this visit in such a way that he could give a new impetus, a new push, right. A new development for the relations between the two countries, and mm-hmm. to make of it a sounder, a better relationship, better cooperation, but in real terms. And this is why they have signed both sides this number of agreements in the fields that you have mentioned, but also in the media field, mm-hmm. as far as I understood.
In the media field. Right. Of course, we're looking to more cooperation with Mauritania. And how do you assess the Egyptian-African relations in general under President Abdel Fattah el-Sisi?
Yes, and the first ever visit that President Abdel Fattah Sisi made, he made to Africa. He didn't go to Europe or to Asia or even to the Arab world, with exclusion of Algeria, because it was the very first country that he has visited. And then he went to attend the African summit that witnessed the coming back of Egypt to the Continental
African
Organization.
Union.
Exactly,
yeah.
The African Union. That was in Equatorial Guinea.
Mm-hmm.
Now, on his way back, he visited Sudan. He visited Khartoum again. He visited Ethiopia. He addressed the parliament there. He has received a big number of African leaders and foreign ministers and other delegations in Egypt. He met with his peers on the sidelines of different international forums, be it in New York or in other places. So in fact, and President Abdel Fattah Sisi has been investing himself as a president very well to serve the good cause of the need to develop our relations with Africa as a whole. Now, we shouldn't forget that at every occasion we invite Africans to come and celebrate with us at the Sharm el Sheikh Economic Conference, at the inauguration of the Suez Canal, and so on. Now, we have hosted the tripartite summit,
right,
of the three regional groupings,
mm-hmm,
the COMESA, SADC, and the ESE. Now, we have held the Africa 2016 forum to engage the private entrepreneurs more in getting together and working together for the service of development in Africa, and to get together with our entrepreneurs in Egypt, but also to open the doors for them to interact with other entrepreneurs coming from other parts of the world.
Mm-hmm.
Now, and this is one of the initiatives. I'm sure that we have in our pocket other initiatives,
mm-hmm,
that we are going to
right,
be.
Sir, you've just mentioned the tripartite summit and the COMESA and SADC being here in Egypt. How far do you think it's important to have more cooperation between African countries?
There is a dream in Africa to establish or to create the African common market, or the African free trade area. Now, we have been at the beginning of the 80s in Abuja, in Nigeria, very realistic, and we said this is something that is going to take about 3 to 4 decades. Okay, and we should proceed gradually.
Right.
Okay?
Mm-hmm.
And at the level of the sub-regional groupings, the SADC, the COMESA, the ECOWAS, the UMA, the what else? The COMESA, mm-hmm, SADC, ECOWAS, ICAS, and UMA, and so on. Now, this is why we, as an important member within the COMESA, we are trying our very best to work with the other members of the COMESA,
mm-hmm,
to create a common market, a real common market between the member countries. And we have succeeded in creating a free trade zone in this regional grouping. So now the regional groupings, they should unite, amalgamate, as we have seen it in Egypt in June last year, and this is this should be followed by other steps.
Yeah.
I mean, to include other regional groupings and to finish by having the all African common markets,
mm-hmm,
to get rid of all restrictions as far as trade, the movement of people, the movement of capitals,
and,
the
right,
movement of,
and
exactly,
right,
of goods, you see,
mm-hmm,
and to get rid of the tariffs, as you said, and customs,
mm-hmm,
and all this. So That was a very important step, what we have witnessed in Sharm el Sheikh in June last year. But we have to ensure the follow-up. Everything needs a follow-up. Mm-hmm. If you do not follow, the process will get longer. Mm-hmm. Okay, and whatever you are aspiring at achieving within such regional grouping or the union of groupings right. is going to take or to find difficulties.
Right, Ambassador Ali Al-Hifti, former Deputy Foreign Minister, many thanks, sir, for joining us and have a good day.
Thank you, my dear.
Dear ladies and gentlemen, with this we come to the end of this edition of Africa Today. Many thanks for watching and stay tuned for more coming up here on Nile TV International.